So for this episode, Odd of Vote, I'm going to be speaking to Richard High and Maggie Gordon-Walker from the Basic Income Southeast organisation. We're going to be talking about the universal basic income, what it is, what it would do, and whether it might be introduced in this country following the coronavirus outbreak. So this is the story, and sit back and enjoy. So I'm here with James Phiri, who is a trustee of Virtual Doctors. James, you're going to tell us all about your organisation. It does some great work abroad, doesn't it? Tell us a bit more about what you do.
Okay. Hello. The Virtual Doctors is a telemedicine charity which exists to link doctors to clinicians in rural health centres, currently in Zambia and Malawi, where we have we are supporting about 140 health centres in Zambia and about 6 in Malawi currently. And the doctors who are in the UK provide hours on a voluntary basis to help those clinical officers in rural health centres to diagnose patients. Very often, those clinical officers in rural health centres do not have ready access to a doctor. And so therefore, this technology enables that interaction to happen and for them to get the support that they need.
Yeah, this is particularly relevant at the current time of the coronavirus outbreak. Has that affected the way that Virtual Doctors carries out its work and the cases that you have?
It does, yes. Currently, if we take Zambia, for example, they have an increasing number of cases. They're doing a whole lot of testing for coronavirus. But particularly in the rural areas, it's much more challenging because, again, they don't have the facilities and the number of doctors that they need. So what the Virtual Doctors have done is we have started a COVID-19 response campaign where we are looking at wash facilities, sanitation and hygiene, and helping those clinics to get the equipment and basic PPE equipment that they need in order to do their jobs effectively.
Yeah. So why is there a need for such a service, you know, based in the UK, in these countries then? Obviously, the obvious answer is they lack some of the medical, the clinicians, the kind of the human resources which, you know, other countries have.
Yes, essentially, the challenge is to do with the number of doctors in the country. There is, particularly in rural areas, sometimes you have one district health director who is effectively looking after a number of clinics, and you end up with clinical officers who are responsible for a clinic being the most senior physician in that locality. So there is a need to link those clinical officers to other medical professionals who are more experienced, who can help them with their workload, and particularly with cases that might be more complicated than they're used to. And by having this telemedicine service, we can ensure that patients are not referred to distant hospitals, and therefore, hopefully, we can also help to reduce mortality rates and help the clinical officers with their ongoing knowledge and education.
Yeah, telemedicine's being used a lot now, isn't it? People are accessing health services remotely, particularly due to the coronavirus outbreak where you have the social distancing measures in place.
Yes, it is. And also, you know, quite apart from ensuring that doctors are available to in country, are available to assist as many people and colleagues as possible without themselves being exposed to the risk. I think telemedicine has now come into its own for that particular need, but also for, in our case, if we're operating in 140 clinics, we're collecting data, live data from those clinics back into the center so they can actually improve their response to you know, the spread of the virus or any other disease, for that matter.
Yeah, and who's behind this organisation? I know you're a trustee, James, but tell us a bit about the background to your organisation, when it was set up, and you, I know you've got quite a number of GPs that that carry out the services.
Yes, the organisation started, was founded by a chap called Hugh Jones, who was working in Zambia more than 10 years ago, and he actually experienced, first-hand experience of you know, giving somebody a lift, a heavily pregnant woman who was trying to get to hospital. He gave this couple a lift, and unfortunately, the woman bled to death in the back of his Land Rover. And it is there that the thought came to him that actually, if that facility, that rural health clinic where the woman was coming from, had had access to, if that clinician had had access to a doctor, then perhaps that death would have been, you know, preventable. So he set about contacting a lot of medical people and people that he knew. And we've ended up with, you know, about 80 doctors in the UK supporting this service. In spite of their hectic schedules, they're actually volunteering their time to help people who are 9,000 miles away in Zambia and Malawi. So it is actually an incredible thing that they're doing. And we're very much indebted to these doctors who are still volunteering to come on board. And it is just amazing the work that they're doing.
Yeah. And you have people on the ground as well as people offering the services remotely. Is that right?
We do. So we have our group of doctors in the UK and also some doctors in Zambia supporting the service. But we also have about 35 people who are volunteers for the service. So we have the trustees and directors, obviously, in the UK. We have one full-time person in the UK as well as one part-time person. And then we have a small team in Zambia of about 5 people who are supporting the service and a board of directors in Zambia as well.
Hello, welcome to Kafue. This is the Kafue Mission Rural Health Center. My name is Asiarindi Greda. I'm the clinic officer and the health center in charge.
So, Mr. Asiarindi, what is the current situation with COVID-19 in your area?
The current situation with COVID-19 is that we are having some cases of COVID-19. This is an isolation one. So if you have got some cases like measles, chickenpox, you are able to isolate the cases in this form. In the chlorine production unit, we are able to produce the chlorine machine inside, whereby we are supposed to we produce chlorine, which we use to disinfect our cleaning. This is my office. This is the administrative office. So that's why I do all my administrative work. This one, the next room, this is an isolation one. So if you have got some cases like measles, chickenpox, you are able to isolate the cases in this form. This one is the chlorine production unit. We are able to produce the chlorine machine inside, whereby we are supposed to we produce chlorine, which we use to disinfect our cleaning.
This is the room of our environmental health officer. This is the room where we do male medical circumcision, as at now only staff is doing the male medical circumcision. This room here, this is our registry. That's where we keep all the patient records.
I can't get up.
We have got two screening loans. This is screening loan number two. I use this loan while screening the patients.
So that's it for the first half. We're going to be speaking in the second half more to James Phiri from Virtual Doctors, and James is going to be telling us more about what that organisation does abroad. So welcome back to the vote. I'm here with James Phiri from Virtual Doctors. I'm going to be speaking more to James about what Virtual Doctors does abroad, and a great staff and GPs and other healthcare professionals that they work with in order to provide their services. Here's what he had to say. How do you recruit people then? How do you raise awareness and about your services? And how do people know about them in the countries that you work in? How do you do that? It must be quite a difficult job.
In country, it entirely depends on the activity we're doing. So if we are onboarding new clinics, what we do is we talk to other organizations, we talk to the Ministry of Health to see if they can support us with vehicles or in any other way, particularly to do with opening routes into the district. Because one can't just go into a district and offer a service, you have to go through the Ministry of Health. So that can be a very difficult process unless you have the backing of the Ministry of Health. So we do recruit volunteers based on word of mouth as well as in the way that we engage with other organizations. In the UK, our medical director, Daniel Grace, does a lot of wonderful work communicating with colleagues in the NHS and beyond and inviting them, telling them about the Virtual Doctors and inviting them if they are able to offer their time. So it's really the population that we have of doctors has grown by word of mouth and by simply talking about the Virtual Doctors and inviting people to participate if they have the time to do so.
Yeah. So give me an example of when Virtual Doctors would be needed then. What kind of conditions do you think that this service would be most useful? I'm thinking cancers, diagnosing cancers, does it go that deeply? Do people kind of do a consultation remotely? When would it be needed in these countries? Give me some examples of the kind of great work that you do.
It is essentially needed for any medical condition where a clinical officer does not feel that they have the experience to diagnose the symptoms they're presented with properly, or maybe they just need a second opinion from a doctor. So it can be anything from, we had a case in recently where a child was in a house or had with the mother. The mother left the dwelling for a time. And unfortunately, there was an accident where boiling water burned this child, was 9 months old, less than 9 months old. And the advice that the doctor here gave the clinical officer was about the importance of using cling film to retain, to help retain the moisture for the baby while they transported them, the baby and the mother, to a local medical facility. Now, that advice might be very simple, but it actually helped to save that child's life. So it can be things that we take for granted here, but it can be critical when a clinician needs advice and does not have the right experience or the right equipment to find alternatives for a particular patient. We've also had instances where a patient has had an X-ray, but there is no radiologist. So what we've had is that an image of that X-ray sent via the telemedicine app, and then we've contacted the right person here, was able to interpret it. So it can vary. It's essentially any condition where the clinician needs advice or support.
Yeah. Do you see this as a future of healthcare globally, really, telemedicine? Do you see it as a way forward of delivering services? Because, you know, GPs, doctors, healthcare professionals don't always need to see the patient, do they? And sometimes it's better and more efficient to do remote consultations. But it depends on the illness, doesn't it, and what needs to be done.
Absolutely. I mean, we've seen examples of that recently, well, currently in the UK, where doctors have started giving video consultations. With the virtual doctors, we have restricted ourselves, however, to just doctors helping the clinician who's on the ground, can see the patient, can actually have a conversation about the symptoms with the patient directly. So we've restricted our response to helping them rather than having doctor to patient. That would be more difficult for us. But in terms of the future, yes, absolutely. I think the ability to have video consultations with doctors will become more and more important. And also for training, for looking at training large groups of people, using the limited numbers of experts that might be available, I think telemedicine is going to be critical for that.
Yeah, tell us about how you're coping at the moment then. You know, I know a lot of NGOs and third sector organisations are under a lot of pressure. How's it been at Virtual Doctors?
It's been much more difficult, obviously, because all the other organisations in the medical space have got their own response programmes at the moment. And our main stakeholder, the Minister of Health, is, they are also very much engaged and quite busy responding to this. So we've been reaching out and making appeals for people to support the work that we're doing. And currently, as I said, we're looking at washing, sanitation and hygiene and the provision of PPE to clinical officers. And we've started this campaign on our website and hoping that people can go to virtualdoctors.org where there's a link to our COVID action campaign. And from there, they'll have more information about what we're doing. They can see what we've done so far and what we intend to do.
Yeah, okay. Do you get any support from the government? I mean, have they been involved? Because I know that, in the past, there's been healthcare programs, for example, the Department for International Development. Do you work with DFID or any of the government departments, devolved governments at all in your work?
Currently, no. We've had some bids in the past which we put into DFID, but DFID, we find that normally they work with much larger organisations than we are. We are a very small operation, a growing organisation, but quite small, and very lead at that. As I said, we've only got 5 staff, some of them part-time on our payroll, but over 100 volunteers. So we don't work directly with the government, but we do have support when we need it. So in-country, the British High Commission, if we need them, they've been very helpful with some links to other organizations. But the short answer is not directly with the government, but we do have support when we need it.
Yeah. What other organisations are there out there that offer virtual doctors? I mean, I'm thinking this could be useful in like remote areas of, well, even the UK, there's remote areas, up in Scotland, for example, some of the islands around there. I mean, this is this a way forward, do you think, in other countries as well?
Yes, as I said, we have seen the emergence of video consultations in the UK. Yeah. We have seen it in other countries around Africa as well. I'm not aware of many other organizations that are doing what we're doing and offering a free service. We are somewhat unique because not only do we provide, not only are our doctors providing a free service, but we provide clinical officers with the mobile phones and we provide them with the data they need to make the calls. And we've also been lucky so far in that the software development itself was also done by volunteers. We will be looking to raise more funds to actually upgrade our software and make it even more accessible. But yes, you know, we've just been very, very blessed with, you know, the people who've lent us their skills in order to make this possible.
Yeah. Just before we go then, how do we find out more about your information, about the service you offer and the further information?
The best way is to go on www.virtualdoctors.org, and on there you will see all the work, information about the work we're doing in Zambia and Malawi. And you will also see the link to our COVID action campaign, where you can help us to raise funds specifically for these rural health clinics.
Brilliant. James, we'll leave it there. Thanks for joining us today. All the best for the future and with Virtual Doctors. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Cheers. I appreciate,
And so my name is Krali Nkongo. I'm the clinical liaison specialist for the Virtual Doctors. And so we are very excited because our food handler stations are ready. And so I'm going to take you through how to set up the food handler station. And of course, as you can see, this is just a skeleton of it. And so we'll go step by step on how to set it up, right? Of course, so we are done setting up our food handler stations. We can put the water here and the soap will be here. And don't touch the handler stations, just use your legs or rather your foot to step on these two areas. I think that's it.
So that's it. We've heard from James Phiri from Virtual Doctors about the great work which that organisation does, particularly during the coronavirus outbreak. Join me more in the future for more episodes of The Vote, but for now, thank you and goodbye.